Well, good morning and welcome to the 8th meeting of the Economy, Jobs and Fair Work Committee. May I remind everyone to turn off any electrical devices that may interfere with the sound systems and also otherwise to turn to silent. Today we welcome three witnesses. Anna Ritchie, Allan, Project Manager, Close the Gap. Emma Ritch, Executive Director of Engender, and Chris Oswald, who's the Head of Policy and Communications, Equality and Human Rights Commission for Scotland, being introduced in no particular order. May I ask members to keep their questions succinct, and also if the witnesses could try to keep their answers focused in the limited time that we have. And also, witnesses may not wish to answer every question. And if they do wish to come in, I would ask them simply to raise their hand so that I can bring them in. No need to worry about the microphones. These are dealt with by the sound desk. So if I might start with a fairly general question. We're here about what is called the gender pay gap. And I thought it might be useful just to ask each of you how that looks in your own organisations. And I don't know who would like to start responding to that. Chris Oswald, perhaps?
I must admit, I hadn't anticipated that question, and I hadn't prepared for it. We do have, from memory, a gender pay gap. I think it is about 6 or 7%. I can come back and give you the exact figures and correspondence. We do have the data. I just wasn't anticipating that question. Sorry.
Right. No, that would be helpful. And I should say as well, if questions are asked and any of you wish to come back to the committee in writing on particular matters, if you want to bring back the detail to us, then please feel free to do that. And indeed, the committee may write to clarify certain matters later. Anna Ritchie Allan?
But we just have women in our organisation.
Right. Sorry, Emma Ritch?
The same. Women tend to be the majority of the workers working on the issue of gender inequality, so we have a pay gap of zero. Because we have no men working for Engender.
I see. Are there similar organisations addressing the issue from a man's point of view who likewise only have men working for them? Not that you're aware of.
I think men into childcare, so organisations and initiatives that work on the issue underpinning the pay gap absolutely would tend to employ men. So men into care initiatives, there's a men into childcare organisation in Scotland. I think the Allan Plus initiative, which was funded through European funding, employed men to do that work. And is it fathers in Fathers Network Scotland, I think they solely employ men, as do other organisations working around men and gender. Abused Men in Scotland springs to mind as a male-only employer.
Right. Okay, well, it's perhaps not the expected or the best first question, so we'll move on to other questions now. And Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener, and good morning to our guests, and thanks very much for coming in. I just wanted to start with a sort of definitional question. When we talk about pay, I would like to get your understanding or further my understanding of what do we mean by pay. Is it basic earnings or does it include other things such as overtime and possibly bonus? So that perhaps is a good place to start so that by comparing pay in some sectors or between genders, we're comparing like by like. So I'd perhaps like to get each of our guests' view on that question, please.
Yeah. It depends on what context you're talking about. So in terms of overtime, when you're calculating the gender pay gap, the public sector equality duty, for example, which requires listed public authorities to publish their pay gap, requires that is calculated on average hourly earnings, excluding overtime. But in the context of equal pay legislation, so if you were taking an equal pay case, a claim, then that would look at pay in the broadest sense. It includes all elements of pay, such as pension, overtime entitlements and basic pay and other elements of pay.
Okay. And perhaps just coming back on that, depending on which definition you use, do you therefore come up with a different level of gap depending on which criteria you use to define pay?
The calculation that you use to calculate the pay gap, if obviously if you use different formulations, if you use the mean, for example, or the median, is that what you're hinting at there?
Yes.
Yeah, okay. So there is no consensus on whether to use the mean or the median. The argument for the median is that in general statistics terms, it's acknowledged as being more robust because it excludes the outliers, so the very low, for example, the very low earners and the very high earners. But Close the Gap, for example, gives preference to the mean because the pay gap itself is gendered by its nature. And therefore, if you exclude the very lowest earners and the very highest earners, those particular earners are the crux of the problem because men are overrepresented among the highest earners and the lowest earners are overwhelmingly likely to be female.
Thank you. That's helpful. Sorry, convener.
Yes, I think Chris Oswald wanted to comment on
that. Yeah, I think it just underlines some of the complexity and the differences between pay gaps and equal pay. A number of equal pay cases will rest on issues about who gets bonuses and to what extent, who gets overtime and to what extent. And again, as Anna suggested, that can be very gendered. We did work a few years back looking at the financial sector, and what we saw was pay being affected by occupational segregation, where women were being channeled into what were perceived as being lower risk areas of activity, so perhaps around insurance. Men were in the boiler house end of the organisation and were attracting higher bonuses as a result of that, the value which was ascribed to the type of work which was being done. So on an individual basis, making those type of comparisons, you can see quite stark differences. But equally, as Anna says, if you look across the average, you get a different type of result. But the overwhelmingly, it's a gendered environment that we're working in.
Thank you. So can I, for the purpose of today's discussion, we will be assuming we're working on the mean figure. Would that be a fair assumption in terms of if we look at the 15.6% pay gap in Scotland, is that's based on the mean calculation?
The 15% is based on the mean calculation and includes the overall figure. So it includes full-time and part-time workers, which is an important point because some organisations will default to the full-time pay gap. But the problem with that is that it excludes just under half of working women. So 42% of women work part-time. And if you look only at the full-time figure, which is lower because part-time pay is on the whole lower, then you exclude the experiences of those women in the pay gap.
Just a final question on that. In looking at the pay gap in this context, is that how other countries do it, just so that we have a good idea in terms of international comparators, because we have evidence showing pay gaps in Scotland compared to other countries, obviously. So it would be good to know we're comparing like with like.
The mean is the global standard, so it affords comparison internationally.
Thank you.
Bill Bowman.
Thank you, convener. Just to follow up on Dean Lockhart, in the sense he was talking about maybe the principles of the calculation, are the panel members confident there are a definitive set of statistics on pay, earnings and employment for women that all these calculations can be taken from?
Emma Ritch.
The figures produced by the Office of National Statistics come from the annual survey for hours and earnings, which is based on employer survey data. So employers are asked to provide information on pay about their designated employees. The challenge with the annual survey for hours and earnings is, while it provides a fairly accurate reflection of the gender pay gap, it doesn't capture other protected characteristic information. And so we have to look at the intersection of gender and, for instance, race, disability, other characteristics need to rely on the slightly more inaccurate labour force survey, which does gather that information about protected characteristics, but is based on surveys administered to individuals about their own recollections of pay, and which is therefore understood to be more inaccurate than the information drawn from payroll systems provided by employers. So that is one weakness with the current annual survey for hours and earnings that Engender would identify.
Right. Anna, Ritchie, Allan.
Yeah, just to add to that, it's patchy overall, and you're more likely to get data which is produced regularly at the UK level rather than at regional, i.e. Scotland level. In particular, there's gaps around skills underemployment, whereby women's underemployment in terms of their skills and qualifications is a significant problem, because so many women find themselves having to reduce their hours to undertake caring responsibilities, but because part-time work is concentrated in lower paid, undervalued jobs, then many women are working below their skill level. Now, the problem with that is there's not official statistics gathered on skills underemployment, but we know that many women are working below their skill level, so that's a significant gap. And I would just agree as well with what Emma said about intersectional data. That's a particular problem.
Chris Oswald, did you want to come
And back? Then lastly, particularly looking at the public sector equality duty, which falls across about 250 public bodies in Scotland and requires them to produce annual data on pay gaps. What we have observed in looking at that is that there can be a wild variation inside a sector, which is to do with how individual bodies have chosen to calculate the gap, who they exclude, who they include. And it's something which Anna, myself and Emma have all been working on with the Scottish Government to try and get agreement on how this should be done. But I think sometimes the variations can be explained by the method.
Thank you. So at the moment, there's no definitive set. Is that the conclusion?
Thank you. I'll move on to a question from Gillian Martin.
I think it'd be really helpful to ask even just one person from the panel to explain to the committee what you define the gender pay gap as being. I think that's something that I think we need to get out there on the record to avoid any confusion about what it is and what it isn't.
Okay. The definition of the gender pay gap is essentially the difference in pay between men and women. So look at all men compared with all women. And as I'd mentioned, you measure that by comparing the average hourly pay of each. In terms of the causes, is that also what you were...
Yeah, just looking at it, not in terms of but looking at it as like over the term of a woman's career path.
Yeah.
And the issues around achievement and destination in terms of women as opposed to men in various sectors.
Yeah, there's a common misconception, I think, that the gender pay gap relates only to pay discrimination, which is exacerbated by stories that we see in the press about the gender pay gap. But there are actually a number of interrelated complex factors which contribute towards the gender pay gap. Occupational segregation, we know, starts, it's a cradle to the labour market problem. We know that gender norms and stereotyping about girls and boys' interests and capabilities results in them eventually studying different subjects at school, in further and higher education, in modern apprenticeships. This becomes further entrenched until you reach the labour market and we see women concentrated in low-paid, undervalued jobs and sectors such as care, admin, retail, cleaning, and men far more likely to be in more technical positions and also in at senior management level. Women still have the disproportionate burden of care for children and for older people, sick people, disabled people. And because there's a lack of flexible working overall, find it difficult to balance work and family life. So many women are then have to take a part-time job, but the only part-time jobs that tend to be available are within the low-paid, undervalued sectors. So the impact of working part-time on your career longer term, there's a long-term scarring effect on your pay, on your promotion prospects, and ultimately on your pension contributions. And then you come to the pay discrimination element, which is often not deliberate and instead is based on the design of paying grading systems that are the way that they consider the different jobs that men and women do and also the different skills that men and women have to do these jobs that results in often women being paid less for equal work.
And it's an economic issue as well. I mean, I'd be interested to know what you all think about the effect it would have on the Scottish economy if we were to close the gender pay gap.
Emma Ritch.
Close the Gap has done some great work on this. There's been efforts made over the years to calculate this this return to economies that could be realised if we just removed the barriers to women's labour market participation fully. Close the Gap has estimated a return to the Scottish economy of £17.2 billion, and that would be the result of resolving this question of allocative inefficiency. So at the moment, we have people working out of their skill sets, we have women being significantly underemployed, and we have girls not pursuing their preferences in education and thereafter because of socially constructed ideas about what girls, boys, men and women should be doing. And all of that comes at a significant cost to the Scottish economy.
And I think that there's maybe a preconception by businesses that by addressing this issue that it's going to be problematic. But actually, I've heard it's actually the case that the companies and organisations that are addressing things around the gender pay gap actually do perform well at, in terms of productivity. Has that been your experience?
Chris Oswald, one.
Yes, I think there's evidence to show that. If I could perhaps just go back a step, and one of the things which I think is instructive is to look at the narrowing of the gender pay gap over time in Britain, also as in Scotland. Now, a lot of people would argue, and I'd very much agree with this, that the narrowing of the gap has got more to do with the reduction in men's pay than it has to anything to do with the increase in women's pay or women particularly penetrating into other areas of the economy where they're better paid. So it's a volatile statistic, and sometimes it's not as obvious as saying the gender pay gap is narrowed, so that's a good thing. It's narrowed because men's earnings have come down, women's earnings have not risen as a result of that. I'd also, again, very much back this the idea that it is a product of segregation and of other aspects of the economy, and is as applicable to disabled people and to some ethnic minority groups as well. It's about the extent to which the work that they do or they themselves are valued, quite crudely, in this situation. So if we're talking about a drag in the economy, then what we have as a drag is an underutilisation of skills. And that by maximising people's participation in the labour market at the highest possible level, that's the benefit we see to the economy. As much as you're measuring it in pounds and pence, it's about people being able to advance and reach their full potential, and what Scotland is missing as a result of not being able to do that or achieve that.
Just to go back to your point there about the business case, there's a lot of evidence around the business case where businesses that have taken steps to advance gender equality and who treat their workforce or have fair and flexible workforce policies are more likely to see improved morale among the workforce, higher productivity. And we also know that when there is gender balance, particularly on senior management teams, that's likely to lead to greater levels of creativity and innovation, and you're more likely to design products and services that are benefit everyone, because men and women bring different experiences to the table. So when it comes to designing those products and services, businesses are more likely to be, and public sector organisations are more likely to be designing services and goods that meet the needs of a wider client or customer base.
Thank you, and it might be helpful if you were able to write into the committee with reference to particular studies or reports that have been done into this area, particularly in Scotland, because there may be not as much for a small country like Scotland, but obviously anything that you're able to feed into that, which you've referred to as evidence, that would be very helpful. I'll move on to Andy Whiteman now.
Thank you, convener. Chris Aldswood already touched on the question of the pay gap in Scotland vis-a-vis the UK and perhaps one reason for that, but do the panel want to reflect on why the pay gap is lower in Scotland? Not a great deal lower, 15.6% compared to 18.1%. And what's the trend been historically for that difference?
It's really hard to model pay gaps. It seems like it should be something that's relatively easy to answer. You know, what proportion of the pay gap is attributable to what set of factors? There hasn't been, up until now, any modelling of the pay gap in Scotland. Although Close the Gap has commissioned some and that work is underway, which I think is extremely helpful. When we look at decompositions done by Wolby and Olson for the Equal Opportunities Commission and then the EHRC, we see that there's quite a lot of unexplained chunk of the pay gap still. So I hope that the work in Scotland will lift the veil on some of the things we don't understand. Widely speculated on is the notion that it's because of the City of London. We know the financial services sector has one of the largest pay gaps. It usually sits just behind manufacturing in the size of gap, and is especially large in those sectors of the financial services sector in which large bonuses are paid and in which bonuses represent a significant proportion of salary. And many of those types of roles are found within the City of London. So the kind of shorthand explanation is that the city skews the rest of UK pay gap, and particularly the pay gap is wider in London. So that's the best intelligence we have really at the moment.
Okay, thank you. I mean, you mentioned the City of London. Mm. Is there good data on regional pay gap variations across Scotland, or are we getting to too small a level there with the statistics we've got available?
Do you want to? It is a difficulty with regionalisation, and because of the way the annual survey for hours and earnings works, the smaller region you're trying to describe, the more difficult that becomes and the less robust the figures are. There are other kinds of pay surveys which are pushed out throughout the year which attempt to answer some of these questions, but they are not based on the rigorous methodology of the annual survey for hours and earnings, and so I would treat them with caution. You occasionally see figures decomposed for local authority areas and for other kind of sub-national geographical areas, but I would treat those with extreme caution. It is possible to look at the factors underpinning the pay gap and to take a view on, for instance, if you know that a local authority area has an extremely large proportion of jobs in, say, farming and tourism, then you could take a view on what impact that's likely to have on the pay gap. But in terms of hard figures, they become increasingly shaky as you look at smaller regional areas.
And getting back to my original question about the pay gap vis-a-vis Scotland and the UK, what has been the trend over time with regard to the pay gap?
Narrowing in terms of the full-time pay gap, but not much movement overall, I would say. Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
And in terms of the variation between Scotland and the UK?
Remaining roughly the same. I would note, as other colleagues have said, that the pay gap is a very top line and very lagging indicator of what happens within the whole of the labour market, and so is affected by a lot of trends. And particularly recent narrowing, I think, could more fairly be attributed to men's precarious, low-paid, underemployed work more than any underlying effects in terms of women's labour market participation.
And how far back can we go and get reliable statistics on the pay gap?
at least 20-ish years, but the measure has changed over time. Okay. So there has been a move within the United Kingdom between the median and the mean, and between the presentation of full-time and part-time. So it is possible to dig back into those figures. But the official ONS statement has changed its methodology during that time.
I think Chris Oswald wanted to come in then, Ritchie Allan.
I think just as an illustration, and again, this issue about the narrowing of the pay gap, what we saw post the 2008 recession was that men were displacing women in what you might describe as traditionally female occupations in terms of care or things like that. Women were not displacing men in traditionally male areas. So we still see areas like construction, manufacturing, where there is a male dominance. So again, the figures themselves are influenced by other factors.
To go back on a point that Emma touched on there about some of the challenges with looking only at headline pay gap figures, the challenges in particular is that businesses and policymakers don't look below that headline figure. Mm-hmm. Because, for example, you could have an organisation that has a 0% pay gap, but yet you still see stark segregation and all the women clustered in the lower grades and all the men clustered in the higher grades. So it's really important actually to see what are the causes of the pay gap, where are the gaps across the organisation, and where are men and women distributed across the workforce.
Thank you. Okay, I think Gil Patterson wanted to come in with a short supplementary, and then yeah. Richard Leonard.
Just on that point, when you see these clusters, is there something with regard to time served, knowing that women maybe, you know, have babies, take time off, maybe wait until child goes to primary school, so that's another gap. So therefore, you know, if a business or a company has got a policy of rewarding, or you know, for people who have stayed with them, does that come into play there?
Did you want to answer? I think sometimes it does come into play when it shouldn't come into play. There are cultural presumptions around women having primary responsibility for childcare and for long-term care, and that undoubtedly severely impacts on their ability to progress within the organisation and to re-enter the labour market if they do have a career break for caring reasons or any other reasons as well. And I think there's a lot of assumptions made by employers about women and whether or not they're going to have children, how they're perceived to be less committed to an organisation if they're not able to be present at their desk for long hours. So many employers will wrongly equate presenteeism with commitment to an organisation. So there's a number of different factors there, I think, and there are some, I think, quite discriminatory practices undertaken by employers about assumptions about women's and men's lives as well.
If I could perhaps just come back to the situation I described earlier about the financial sector, where we saw really quite stark occupational segregation, where women being placed into particular lower risk and so therefore lower bonus attracting types of work, and a perception that men were better placed in the kind of boiler room part of the economy, the risky part, which links to things like presenteeism, long hours, so a bias in the way that the organisation perceives itself and how it values its staff and the roles which it then ascribes beyond that.
Just a quick follow-up on that. I mean, certain jobs now don't require physical presence because of the internet, so there's possibly more... Do you see more opportunity for people who can't have that physical presence at a workplace because they can do remote working now? Is that helpful in this area, or have you seen much evidence of that?
Yeah, I think there are definite opportunities, and we do see... the take-up of flexible working increasing, but still there's a big mismatch between the number of people who want to work on a flexible basis and the availability of flexible working, in that there's just not the demand there. We still see a cultural presumption against flexible working in some organisations, where we do know that businesses that do operate flexible or agile working, as it's sometimes called, are more productive when employees are able to work in a way that suits their lives.
I take it you'd accept some jobs, though, require someone to actually physically be present.
Yep.
Yeah. Sorry, Emma Ritch.
I was just going to comment on the procurement of IT systems that may or may not enable home working. And something that I have seen in working with large private sectors around the question of what barriers there are in place to women's progression, that has been identified as a factor which is often not considered when the procurement of IT systems are happening. And so it would be possible for workers to work from home, to work flexibly, and potentially to meet business need by being available to clients through a greater proportion of the 24-hour global working cycle that some enterprises are involved with. But actually, during the procurement of IT systems, the question of home working, the question of how that might advance gender equality, wasn't taken into account. And so there was no reason for it, but it just hasn't been included in what the company has decided to do in terms of its IT solutions. And so I think it does speak to the need, to me, for companies to be taking a kind of gender mainstreaming approach to systems procurement, which I think is not in evidence across all enterprises in Scotland.
Chris Oswald, want to come in, and then we'll come to Richard Lund.
Perhaps a positive example of that is some of the work that BT have done, where they have quite a large home working employment group, which benefits women, it benefits parents with young children, whoever is looking after the young child. It potentially benefits disabled people as well. So there are strong economic reasons, but it needs to be, as Emma's suggesting, it needs to be a conscious decision to do this rather than a consequence of something which has been arrived at. So the investment in IT to be able to work from home, but also accessible IT, which disabled people can use. We have very high levels of unemployment amongst people with sensory impairments. If we have proper IT systems, people will be able to work from home. Equally, just in terms of the economic exclusion of disabled people, the reason why somebody may be unable to work could be to do with their transport. So again, it's not anything to do with their skills, it's the fact that they can't physically get to an office. So home working is a very attractive option if the infrastructure is there to support them.
Right. Richard Leonard.
Thanks, convener. In 30 days' time exactly, new gender pay gap reporting legislation will be enacted. Do you think it will make any difference?
I think it's a welcome step, first step in the right direction. It's something that we've been looking to see for a while. So from April, large private and third sector organisations in the UK will be required to report on their gender pay gap and also their gender gap in bonus earnings. This is welcome because at least it brings private and third sector organisations, larger ones, in line with the accountability that we see in Scotland's public sector. But I think the main flaw in the regulations is that there's no requirement in employers to take any action to address any pay gaps. So you can just publish your pay gap and that's it. I think there's some concerns about compliance and enforcement, which Chris might want to pass comment on. But I think the proof will definitely be in the pudding. Certainly, one of our concerns is that as we're planning at Close the Gap, what work we'll undertake to assess Scottish companies who are required under the legislation is that at present, the database of employers that's available, you can't search for Scottish companies within it. So it makes it difficult to identify who exactly is required to report.
I would very much agree with that. And I think there's also an issue about the kind of the model of change which is being employed, that if you believe that transparency in itself will result in organisations changing their behaviour, one of the fears, I think, is that if a fine system were put in place, or even a name and shame system put in place, is that going to be effective, particularly if we're talking about relatively low levels of fines? There's still some uncertainty at the moment, I have to say, about the enforcement of the new regulations coming in. Obviously, a large number of companies are suddenly coming in to the area, and there's an issue for the Commission in terms of our ability, frankly, to be able to monitor an extra 1,500 companies in Scotland. 7,000-8,000, I think it is, across Britain. So it's a huge area. I would love to believe that transparency in itself would work in that situation, but I don't see a lot of other examples of that. I think it's instructive to look at the Low Pay Commission's work in this area, where, again, they have been quite rigorously identifying cases and bringing companies to account, rather than relying on the companies to disclose themselves. And I think, given some of the difficulties that we've already identified about how the calculation is made, how quickly we will get to a point where we are confident the figures are actually reflective of what's happening inside companies is, again, an issue which I think will take some time to bed in.
What I would say is that the regulations are much clearer than the Scottish specific duties about how to calculate the pay gap, which is really helpful. However, our own experience of attending briefings that are employer briefings that are organised by lawyers is that there's already widespread tuition jealousy on how to see loopholes in that you can divide your company up so that your partners aren't included within the gender pay gap figure and segment your workforce so that your pay gap is lower.
Right. I'll bring Ash. Sorry. Did you have another
just a brief follow-up. I mean, reflecting on your experience, and you've all mentioned this in previous answers, reflecting on your experience with the public sector duty, I mean, is there evidence that that's made any difference whatsoever, that they have to annually report equal pay information? Has the gap closed in the public sector in the last 6 years?
The assessment work that Close the Gap has done, so we've done two assessments. We're just approaching the final reporting period of the first 4 years of the public sector equality duty. We've done reporting assessment of the first reporting in 2013 and a follow-up in 2015. And I think we were being quite disappointed about performance, which has been over the board quite poor. We've seen an actual regression in performance. Two-thirds of the organisations which we assessed actually achieved a lower score in 2015 than they did in 2013. And that already was poorer performance than what we'd seen under the gender equality duty. Mm. So I think there's a sense from organisations working on gender, such as Engender and Scottish Women's Aid, who also do some work on the public sector equality duty, and the EHRC, that really we need to see some concerted efforts to really increase compliance across the public sector.
Thank you. Chris Oswald, did you want to
come? I think the other thing to point out is that we are 30 days away from the end of the first cycle of the public sector duties. The Commission will be doing a very in-depth assessment of what the impacts of that are, which we suspect should be available August, September. So it's possibly too early to judge at this point. But I would very much agree with Anna's observations that it's taking time for this to bed in. We will get the first indication of the first four-year cycle in about 30 days' time. But again, we need to be conscious of, I think the real value of the duty is that it makes organisations conscious of what's going on inside their organisation, which previously may not have been. It also requires them to do something about it. And I think it's the what do they do about it is as interesting. So when we're looking at the data that we'll be gathering from the start of next month, it will be very much less perhaps about has the pay gap narrowed, but what have you actually done? How conscious is the organisation, and how has pay gap thinking influenced its approach to policy, to recruitment, to other areas of the activity?
Thank you. Ash Denham.
Thank you. Obviously, occupational segregation has been touched on by most of the panel already this morning as a factor in this. Chris, you mentioned women being funneled into certain roles, and Anna, you spoke about this starting quite early with girls choosing certain subjects at school So I suppose maybe avoiding maybe math, science and computing, those type of subjects in preference for other things. I'm just wondering, is there any evidence that that's changing? So obviously it's a long time since I made my choices, say 30 years ago I was choosing what subjects to study. Have things improved in the last 30 years?
No.
No.
And I would say that probably one of the key challenges is the lack of mainstreaming, gender mainstreaming, across the education and skills system in particular. So solutions that we've seen so far in the form of a myriad of interventions about, for example, getting more girls and women into STEM subjects, which are laudable, of course. Mm-hmm. They tend to evaluate very well, but the problem is that they actually affect just a very small number of girls and women, and they're usually quite intensive. They take a lot of resources, and you might end up with, I don't know, a smallish number of young women going on to study engineering, but they're very expensive, so they're difficult to scale up. Mm-hmm. So what organisations working to advance gender equality advocate is gender mainstreaming, which is a requirement of the public sector equality duty, but overall we don't see that at all. So what we need to see is that every primary, secondary school, every early years provider needs to consider gender segregation, and then also in further and higher education to consider how every single policy that they have can work to reduce gender segregation and therefore occupational segregation, and we're so far from that just now.
Okay. Emma Ritch.
Just as an indicator of the intransigence of this problem, New York University put out a study this week that said that girls as young as six believe that brilliance is a male trait. And that has a projected impact on their participation in school, and then, as Anna says, progression on through some of these coded male subjects, science, technology, engineering and maths. We've been talking to the Equality and Human Rights Committee about the issue of sexualised bullying in schools, which has a very clear link with girls' participation in the classroom and thereafter. 25% of 11 to 16-year-olds told Girl Guiding UK in 2015 that sexual harassment stops them speaking out in class. And so there's an enormous challenge, I think, to tackle some of the toxic environments in which we're expecting girls and young women to learn. I think we'd also want to see some of this bringing forward of the age of interventions into some of Scotland's policy spaces, taking a mainstreaming approach, as Anna outlined, developing young workforce, for example, focuses the gender equality actions within it, which are enormously welcome, on the modern apprenticeship programme, which has long been totemic for gender advocates, so that is helpful, but also on higher and further education, and that's simply too late. If we're not in this in early years and beforehand, then we're missing vital opportunities to take a gendered approach to education.
And I was going to ask as well, because we've spoken about this before, we were talking about biological sciences.
Mm-hmm.
And so even if women are studying these academic subjects and they're graduating, often with very high marks, mm-hmm. and they go into that sector, there are very few of them to be found about 10 years later. Can you explain what the workplace, you know, the factors are there?
Sure. So I think within a lot of sciences, there's held to be something called a leaky pipeline. So you have girls achieving at school and university. It's widely reported that girls are actually achieving more qualifications, although in different subject areas. But those in non-traditional areas, so the hard sciences, if you will, tend to detach at each stage in larger numbers than their male colleagues. So they disappear through further degrees into PhDs and then postdoctoral research, and then are very few and far between in kind of professorial and also commercial science roles. There's libraries full of information about why this should be. The academic environment can be quite challenging for women in terms of, as Gil Patterson talked about, combining that with having children. So your assessment in terms of of research output, that the whole approach of for doing that does not sit very well with maternity leave. And so women's research contributions are often not counted. A system in which somebody has to be identified as a principal investigator on a large piece of research is often not given to women because you can't change the principal investigator in some research council funded work. So the risk of women having children is seen to be too much. There are a wide range of other factors, inhospitability of working environments, and all of these factors together, systemic and cultural, combine to make science not the, the warm and welcoming place to women that it should be, which is a problem for all of us because, as Anna described, diversity of thinking around the table leads to diversity of ideas and diversity of products and services and innovation. And I wonder what scientific discovery Scotland has foregone because we have not yet got a grip of this issue.
John Mason. Sorry, Chris.
Yeah, just Oswald, very briefly.
And then John Mason.
I think it's particularly evident when you look at the key sectors of the Scottish economy identified by the Scottish Government and the potential opportunity there through putting some conditions around economic development, aid or procurement, that we could actually start to push the issue. It's depressing to look at areas like life sciences, biopharma, and perhaps alternative energy, which potentially as new industries you would hope might have new thinking, but have a tendency to ape some of the worst aspects of the traditional economies. We are in a programme at the moment of building 50,000 new affordable houses in Scotland. 17% of the construction industry as jobs are with women. So, you know, there are real opportunities to increase the benefit, the pool of labour and the economic benefit of significant investment. And so again, it's not no one thing is going to resolve this. If there were a magic bullet, we would have found it many years ago. But it's a coordinated set of action. And I think seeing things like procurement and economic development aid having conditions around equality, as we are seeing around perhaps social deprivation and inclusion of people, there, to see that thinking expanded to gender, to race, to disability would be extremely welcome.
John Mason.
Hey, thanks, convener. I mean, following on really the same kind of themes. I get the impression sometimes that the schools are doing their best and the schools have got the children for, I don't know, 6-7 hours a day, but the families can be very resistant to a girl studying physics or going into engineering and they've got the kid for 16 hours a day. So the family wins. So, how can we change that if it's a kind of cultural or background bias or whatever we want to call it?
I suppose I would push back slightly on the idea that the schools are doing the best, because they're not, frankly. But I take on board your point about parental influence, because we know Close the Gap has a work stream which works with children and young people to try to address gender segregation called Be What You Want. And we've done some work in schools and with teachers and with careers advisors. And confirming what we knew is that children are influenced by the world around them. So it doesn't just come down to, say, parents, for example, but parents are massively influential in children's lives. But so are their peers, and so are teachers, and careers advisors can be as well, given that they only have a limited time spent with children. But children are also massively influenced by the world around them. So the media sends very, very clear messages to children and young people about what girls and boys' position in the world should be and what their interests and their skills are as well. So, but certainly engaging with parents is quite a tough nut to crack, I think.
If I could perhaps add to that, just that if you look at, say, Sweden or Scandinavia, there are better role models for young women there because in those countries there has been a conscious investment in childcare, so it makes it possible for women to go into the labour market. So again, it's about stretching what's seen to be possible in terms of aspiration.
Sorry.
I was just going to note that Sweden also has cracked the tough nut of boys' achievement in education by taking a gendered approach right from early years through to education, which looks at the question of segregation, but also looks at the question of masculinity and good classroom conduct and literacy and a whole range of other things which we think might be behind boys' relative underperformance in schools. And so I think it might be helpful for the committee to note the evidence that exists that suggests that tackling gender, taking a gendered approach all the way through the educational pathway is good for boys and good for girls, and ultimately may lead some years hence to producing young people and then workers who have less stereotypical assumptions about what boys and girls, men and women should be.
Can I just ask you what you mean? I'm not an expert in all of this. Gendered approach, what that exactly means?
So they've essentially looked at pedagogy within the classroom, how things are taught, what content of books is, what content of lessons is, and tried to remove the unwitting, sometimes, gendered messages that sends. So, for example, the Educational Institution of Scotland did some research over a decade ago looking at children's books and what they said about the roles of girls and boys within them, and they discovered a preponderance of princesses, ballet dancers who were female, and the boys and men within the children's books were pirates, spacemen, adventurers, you know, had a wide range, doctors, had a wide range of roles. And sadly we see that kind of unwitting gendered messaging still occurring in children's literature today. So in Sweden, they took, for example, an effort to try and remove some of that to provide balance in the books they read children, to consider the ways that teachers and educators spoke to the young people about their future prospects, and that has made a significant difference in how the children behaved in the classroom, how they learnt, and also the outcomes for those children and young people.
Okay, thanks. Can I have one?
We're just running a bit short on time, so I was wanting to move on to a question from Gordon MacDonald, if that's all right, Deputy Convener.
Thanks very much, Convener. Point that was touched on earlier, there was a report in 2016 by the TUC that suggested that in the UK, by the age of 42, mothers who are in full-time work are earning 11% less than full-time women without children. Now, how do you close that gap? Because presumably that gap exists because the women that have chosen not to have children are being awarded for their experience or for their continued professional development, their investment in time in that. How do you close the gap with those two issues?
Looking at it from the other aspect, it's about not penalising women who do choose to have children and who go on maternity leave, and also looking at the cultural presumptions about who takes care of children on leave. And there's been some tentative steps, I would say, in the implementation of shared parental leave in an attempt to try to rebalance the caring responsibilities, with very limited success, I think, for a number of different reasons, probably part of another discussion. But supporting, in fact, Chris will have something to say about this. The HRC has done work on pregnancy and maternity discrimination, which is really the crux of the issue here. So,
I think quite simply, it's fascinating. Men do not have the same economic penalty through having children as women do. And there's something really quite stark in that. In terms of pregnancy, we've been doing a lot of work on pregnancy discrimination. Our research, which has been updated from 10 years ago, demonstrates an increase in pregnancy discrimination. About 5,500 women a year in Scotland, we believe, are losing their jobs, either directly or feeling pushed out, simply because of pregnancy and maternity issues. It's thrown up a lot of issues about good practice, a lot of issues about confusion, I think, amongst employers. To be fair, the vast majority of employers in Scotland appear to be doing the right thing. There's about 20% of employers where we have a particular concern. And it's two different groups. And again, it's how these things fall. Younger women, often in unskilled or ununionised and casual employment, being sacked when they say they're pregnant. Older women, more in more professional situations, being passed over for promotion, not getting training, not having the same sort of investment. So again, it's these perceptions inside industry of value and worth of and commitment. But as I say, you come back to the fundamental point, men simply do not face the same penalty that women do through having families.
And you've rightly identified that, you know, women carry out most of the childcare. But looking at the PwC's Women in Work Index that just came out last month, it looks at the top three countries, Iceland, Sweden and Norway, and there are less females in part of the workforce in Scotland than these three countries. And more stark than that is there is women in full-time employment as a proportion of all females in employment. In Scotland's at 58%, Iceland's 76%, Sweden's 82%, and Norway's 72%. Is there a cultural issue here that we're missing?
Emma Ritch, I think, wanted to come in on that.
Yeah, I think that point is well made, and there's not a cultural question. I think there's a systemic issue of where those nations have invested. And what they've done is they've invested in childcare. We have a presumption, I think, in the UK that the way we've organised our economy is almost inevitable. And we have a 1.5 breadwinner model within our families, essentially, where it's most usual, although not universal, that we have a male full-time worker and a female part-time worker. And I absolutely agree that maternity discrimination is a big deal. But I think a lot of that 11% will be because we simply don't have part-time work available at the same level of skill and therefore pay as we have full-time work. In the three countries you've listed, they don't have a 1.5 breadwinner model within their families. It's vanishingly unlikely that anybody works part-time unless they're either a student or they're tapering their employment on the run-up to retirement. And so women with children and women without children both work full-time. And the way that they can do that is because they have childcare that enables them to do that, and a cultural presumption that childcare is as good as any other form of care. They have a professionalised childcare workforce, paid at an appropriate level to their skills and experience and knowledge, and that's how their system operates. We have a very different system of childcare, even noting recent improvements and commitments to provide more in Scotland.
Just a final point. A report that came out this month from the Fawcett Society, Gender Pay Gap by Ethnicity in Britain. Mm. You mentioned cultural presumptions. The opening sentence of that summary says, Fawcett Society research has shown that the gender pay gap in Britain is shaped by racial inequality. And it highlights that Black Caribbean women's reverse the gender pay gap with Black Caribbean men. Chinese women in Britain have closed their gender pay gap with white British men. And there's another example about Irish women as well. So, you know, how can we have these cultural differences in different ethnic groups and yet we're saying there isn't a cultural difference within the main population?
I'm not sure I understand that point. I suppose, but reflecting on what you said, that yes, there is absolutely, there's no one single experience for all women, and that different groups of women, so Black and minority ethnic women, disabled women, LGBT women, all experience multiple and complex barriers in different ways. And we really need to take an intersectional approach if we're going to close the pay gap and reduce the barriers that different groups of women experience.
Right. Thank you very much. I'm afraid our time is gone. I think the committee will probably come back on one or two issues to ask for further submission in writing, and you may wish to yourselves put in further comments on some of the questions and issues that have been raised. Perhaps as a sort of final and very quick question, what can the Scottish Government do about all of this? Now, that's perhaps a very unfair question to be dealt with in a minute or two, but that may be something you'd like to come back on in terms of your further written comments, but I'm happy for you to give a quick comment each now if you wish.
Develop a national strategy to reduce the pay gap. We've never seen that. We've just seen bits and pieces of quite piecemeal action that hasn't really resulted in any substantive change.
Yeah, we would support that entirely, and note that apart from anti-discrimination law, Scotland has the power to act on all of the causes of the pay gap, and so we would want to see a concerted push on this single indicator, which has been too persistent for too long.
Be more Scandinavian.
Well, thank you very much.
Scandinavia has consciously chosen a path. We haven't, and I think that's the real distinction.
Right, I'll thank all of our witnesses, and we'll suspend the session for 5 minutes to change over to our next panel. Thank you very much. Okay. Well, welcome back to committee members, and welcome to our new guests. This is a roundtable format that we have here in this particular session. And in the interest of hearing as much as possible from witnesses, I'd ask members of the committee, and that includes myself, to keep questions succinct and to the point. If anyone wants to come in, simply raise your hand. The sound desk will look after the microphones. And I would ask our guests now to simply give us their name and a very brief introduction of who they are. And perhaps I could start on my left with Dr. Irina Merkurieva.
Yes, I'm a lecturer at the University of St. Andrews, and I'm a labour economist working on the intersection of retirement and gender issues.
Thank you.
Emily Thomson, I'm a senior lecturer in the Department of Law, Economics, Accountancy and Risk at Glasgow Caledonian University, and I work closely with the Women in Scotland's Economy Research Centre there. My previous work has been around gender and modern apprenticeships and evidencing the business case for gender equality measures.
Thank you.
My name is Ian Wall. I'm chair of STEMEC, the STEM Education Committee, which was established some 60 years ago by Scottish Government as an independent committee, and we advise government on STEM education.
I'm Patricia Findlay. I'm Professor of Work and Employment Relations at the University of Strathclyde, where I'm the Director of the Scottish Centre for Employment Research, which has as one of its core themes gender inequality and regulation issues. I also, wearing another hat, I'm the Academic Advisor to Scotland's Fair Work Convention.
Thank you.
I'm Professor Fiona Wilson. I'm a professor in organisational behaviour at the University of Glasgow in the business school there. I've been working on a couple of research proposals on equal pay and also recently published a paper on the topic.
I am Wendy Loretto. I'm Professor of Organisational Behaviour and Dean of the University of Edinburgh Business School. My research area is on the intersection between gender and age over the life course, with a particular focus on later working life.
Thank you very much. Just a general starter question. I suspect the academics here and our guests, that is, will be familiar with the Scottish Funding Council report, the recent report in August last year. And I think what it brought out was the fact that the gender balance of Scottish domiciled undergraduate entrance to university in 2014-15 was roughly 58% female and 42% male. And then in the introduction to the paper, what was said was this, that their ambition was that by 2030, the proportion of male students studying at undergraduate level at university will be at least 47.5%. Or to put it another way, the gap between male and female participation will be reduced to 5%, and that no college or university subject will have a gender imbalance of greater than 75% of one gender. So I suppose there's two aspects to that. One is the gender imbalance and the larger proportion of female students, and then this issue of specific subjects having a gender imbalance greater than 75%. So perhaps one or two of our panel might like to give some general comment on that. I don't know who might like to start. Professor Loretto.
Speak from business. We've been going through Athena Swan, which is promoting gender equality in academic subjects, started off in the STEM subjects, moving to wider subjects including social sciences. We have not. We have slightly more women than men coming into education, not just at undergraduate level, but also at postgraduate. So that partly, as you alluded to in the question, is the subject choice. And I think in terms of actually a challenge for us is making sure in terms not so much our intake, but actually what we do with the students when they're with us to ensure that we're actually getting equal achievement amongst men and women, because women are outperforming the men in terms of their achievement as well. And it goes back to some of the questions that we heard from the first evidence session, or some of the responses rather, about different forms of learning and having pedagogic adjustment to the ways in which men and women learn. That's as much of an issue in further and higher education as it is amongst school education, as we heard earlier.
Thank you. Yes, Emily Thomson.
Thank you. Yeah, I mean, I would
absolutely agree with what Wendy's saying about the pedagogical approaches within different subject areas. So in my subject area, I teach economics, I teach business students and social science students. And within that, there's issues around perception of certain subjects and understanding what subjects are about. And within economics discipline, there's the kind of perception among students that it's very technical, very hard and scientific. And it can be, but there's also more to it in those senses. And my sense is that that might be similar in engineering and science subjects, that is about changing perceptions. And the panel earlier on, we're talking about coming at it from an early age. And I think that's really important, that once we get to the higher end, further education scenario, there's most of the work, most of the opportunities have kind of been missed in terms of challenging perceptions and challenging those gendered norms around pedagogy and subject choice.
Thank you. Professor Wall.
I think just picking up on the Athena Swan experience, I think it's instructive in this respect as well, that Athena Swan, I think 2005 when it was first introduced and it was voluntary, but then two research areas made it mandatory that either have silver or bronze. And up until then, what had been very patchy in its take-up suddenly became very enthusiastically taken up by the university, because otherwise they wouldn't get the research grants. So the conclusion I draw is that encouragement is good, but compulsion works.
Right. I was going to then move on to our first question. On, I think it's statistics, we're now moving to Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener. Just wanted to get feedback in terms of the best form of statistics to look at when we are looking at the gender pay gap. We heard from the previous session about the median approach and the mean approach in terms of how you calculate it. Because we are looking at pay, which is an arithmetic sum, I'd like to get our guests' views on the best measurements available either in Scotland or a UK-wide basis in terms of how we can most precisely calculate the gender pay gap.
Professor Findlay.
I think my answer would be that there is no best measurement, but there are a set of measurements which are helpful in different circumstances, and it partly relates to what it is you want to uncover. So when we look at, I'm sure you heard this morning, when you look at median gender pay gap, you're interested in what's the broader experience of most people. When you're looking at the mean, you're trying to take into account some of the really particular problems at the higher level, the higher pay decile area. I think that issues around whether you use average pay or hourly pay, again, it depends what your objective are. So if your objective is, for example, to look at differences in the pay gap as a rate for the job, that's a different objective to whether or not you're looking at differences in women and men's earnings. So it depends on what your question is. I think there are a suite of measures, and the measures are largely agreed in the sense of what their composition is, although different bodies use different measures. I think one of the big challenge is how you translate those measures into something that's applicable within workplaces. So I don't think there's a great deal of disagreement about what the options are or the suite of measures are at a national level and at a research level. I think the issue is, how do we get measures that people can understand and then can translate into something that impacts on workplace practice?
Professor Loretto.
I would like to argue as well for more comprehensive measure that takes into account pension entitlements and contributions, because in terms of the pensioner poverty, where number of women that are in pensioner poverty far exceeds the number of men, and thinking about auto-enrolment, which has been a very good introduction, very good initiative, but actually the number of women, particularly women working part-time, that fall beneath that threshold in order to be able to be involved in auto-enrolment is still very high. The TUC did a survey a few years ago where it said that up to half of women working part-time were below that auto-enrolment threshold. So actually, if we don't look at that as well in terms of calculating gender pay, actually what we're looking at is future generations being put into poverty far beyond their time in the paid workforce.
Emily Thompson.
Thank you. And I would add to that bonus pay and overtime pay, because I think we have some evidence that men have more access to this within the labour market. And I think the tendency to use the median headline kind of figure in comparing full-time hours
underplay some of the structural barriers. So the fact that some of those high-earning outliers are almost exclusively male, if we take the labour market as a whole, and that women are overrepresented at the lower end of the pay distribution, isn't reflected in median reports of median full-time comparisons. If we compare full-time men's full-time earnings with women's part-time earnings, we see a very big gender pay gap start to arise. And of course, we know that women are much more likely to be in part-time employment. I think it's around 41% at the moment versus about 12% of men. So some of these measures, these headline measures, can really underplay the structural barriers. And I personally like to see both the mean and the median reported where possible, so we get a fuller picture.
Just one follow-up question. Within each category, the median and the mean, how definitive are the numbers in terms of, are they based on surveys? Are they based on audited financial statements from different companies or the public sector, perhaps? If I could get a bit of some feedback on that question.
The most definitive account we have of hours and earnings is from the annual survey of hours and earnings, which is carried out through using HMRC records, and it takes into account 1% of businesses in terms of their HMRC reports. So in terms of robust data, that's very robust, and ASH it's good for Scotland, because when you start to disaggregate it, you don't start to lose sample size in the same way that you do sometimes with, for example, the labour force survey.
Okay, I think Gillian Martin wanted to come in, and then Professor Wall, did you want to make a quick point on the previous before Gillian comes in?
It was just to say that the wider issue, that, I mean, when Emily talks about the bigger picture, is Scotland is really poor in statistics, and it's very difficult. I mean, this is wearing a different hat of deputy of the SCDI, and some of our members are concerned that we don't have enough knowledge, whatever judgments you might draw from it. And although the statistics you refer to are easily, there are other British-wide statistics that are very difficult to interpret for Scotland, and then there are whole areas that are not touched upon at all. And then particularly when you talk about the questions of intersectionality, which were raised at the earlier session, you need a lot more figures than just the wage. I mean, that's an important place to start, but it needs to be wider than that. And if the committee were to give consideration to the sort of knowledge it and the Parliament as a whole requires in order to make a contribution to really understanding Scotland and improving it, then I think that'd be very valuable.
And may I ask, does sectionality, would that include the differences in different age brackets? Because earnings opportunities can vary markedly, can they not?
Yes.
Yeah. And Gillian, Professor Wilson, and then Gillian Martin.
About the intersectionality. There's some very interesting new research which is now raising the issue of class. So those who come from better backgrounds are earning higher wages, in, for example, law. And so there are issues right across the spectrum of where inequalities can happen.
Okay, Gillian Martin.
So we've heard that women achieve better at HE, FE, postgraduate level. They do very well, but they're still not reaching the same heights in terms of the career progression or the pay levels of their male counterparts as they go through a career. So the problem, for me, that suggests that the problem is with the workplace. But what I want to ask you all, or anyone that wants to come in, companies are missing a trick here, aren't they, if they're not realising the full potential of the female workforce that they've got on offer. And I think this, for me, is the crux of the matter. You can put all the legislation you want in place, but this is an economic opportunity that companies in the Scottish economy are missing. And I wonder if anyone wants to give their view on that analysis.
Professor Wilson.
In September 2016, that argued that narrowing the UK pay gap has the potential to create an extra £150 billion on top of the business-as-usual GDP forecast in 2025 and create 840,000 additional female employees. So there are organisations such as McKinsey and Deloitte that are, you know, the big consultancy companies that are laying out facts and figures about what the business case is for greater equality in terms of pay. And the messages are very strong and very clear.
I think Professor Findlay and Emily Thomson want to come on in on that as well.
I mean, it's a similar point in the sense that there are estimates that you could add around 1.3 to 2.4% of GDP if you improve sex discrimination within organisations. But to come back to your original point, I think there is a huge issue within the workplace. So we know that the gender pay gap is multidimensional, and we know that it's caused by factors that predate the workplace. The chair's first question was raised some issues, I suppose, which we didn't discuss around the different pipelines into how people, how women get to the workplace and men get to the workplace and experience different things. But the reality is a lot of this plays itself out in the workplace. One of the things which I'm very struck by is as women have increasingly improved their own human capital, the argument was always that women didn't invest in their human capital to the same extent. As women have increasingly improved their human capital, they haven't been paid back for that in terms of the workplace experience. So the issue becomes, how do you then influence and change workplace practice and workplace experience to affect those outcomes? The workplace is absolutely crucial.
A few points then that I would like to add to what Patricia said. In terms of the business case, so there's kind of two dimensions to the business case. There's the macroeconomic arguments that have been mentioned, and organisations like the IMF, the World Economic Forum are publishing lots of statistics and lots of analysis that indicates that if we could close those gender gaps, we could increase GDP and make the most of our economy, etc., etc. For individual companies, there is quite a lot of academic evidence that suggests that there's cost minimisation around eliminating discrimination. There's protecting against litigation that's costly in the workplace, etc. There's also that idea of making the best possible use of the talent available to companies. And particularly in terms of vertical segregation, so looking at the underrepresentation of women on company boards, for example, there's really quite robust evidence that correlates the presence of women or the gender balance in the boardroom with economic benefits in different measures of performance, return to equity, return to sales, et cetera, et cetera. And those are around, as had been mentioned in the session earlier on, those are around building better teams, making better decisions, but also around representing marketplaces and proximity to markets, so women are more able to market more effectively to female consumers. But on Trisha's point around human capital, I think that's absolutely accurate. So we used to have this approach that women choose to be overrepresented within the low pay because they expect lower returns on their human capital investments. And we know now that there isn't, that they don't get the returns on the human capital that they perhaps deserve. And it is about the workplace. And I think perhaps, as was mentioned in the panel earlier, childcare has something to do with that, because we know that there's a link between those that are doing all of the unpaid caring in the economy and not having access to paid work. There's got to be a link between those two things. If you are doing a lot of unpaid care, you don't have the same time and energy left over to engage in the labour market in the same way. And therefore, I think we need to think about the childcare infrastructure as being crucial to addressing these workplace issues. And we also have to think about data in terms of unpaid work, because we don't really know a lot about what's going on in the household. Sorry, that was a very long
response. And I won't take too much time, but recruitment practices as well, would they have an impact? And for example, we mentioned that flexible working never really been advertised. It's something that you have to ask for when you're actually in work, which kind of marks you out as maybe needing special treatment. Would that make an impact?
I think it probably does, that we see not very much quality part-time employment available in this economy. And as Emma Richard mentioned earlier on, we have this 1.5 kind of model of familial configuration. And if we had more quality part-time jobs available, this would be very helpful. You're not often seeing very high-level management jobs, for example, available as a job share or on a part-time basis, and I think that could be really helpful if this was something that we saw more often.
And Dr. Merkurieva wanted to come in on this as well.
On these several issues. One is that I think that relative to everything else, we're doing fairly well at recruitment stage, and one reason is that it's at least better than in other areas, it's fairly observable. You often have very comparable skilled workers, and it's easier to offer similar terms and conditions and avoid the pay gap. We have a lot of evidence that in contemporary world, a lot of difference accumulates post-recruitment over their career time. And it's not just so childcare and childbearing age and so on. This is all very important, but unfortunately, that's not everything. Single women, women who never have children, still diverse from their male peers. And one piece of evidence that we have is negotiation of pay and conditions in the workplace. Mm-hmm. So from so it's like experimental lab evidence that males are more likely to be aggressively involved in negotiations. Women would take both their initial offers and renegotiations at later stage as a take it or leave it offer. And there can be some straightforward intervention. So one way to think about it is a female worker is not considering, so is more satisfied with the status quo rather than considering a progression path. You want to stimulate people to think what other functions and be more proactive in terms of taking these functions upon themselves. So that's an intervention that has been successfully implemented here in Scotland, for example, for unemployed workers, transitioning from looking for vacancies that are very closely related to a job that you've lost to vacancies that are in broader areas that pays back a lot. Similarly, for female workers focused on a particular set of functions, moving to kind of soliciting extended range, that can be also an intervention that helps, so that this lifespan.
I think Jackie Bailey wanted to come in, and then Professor Loretto and also Professor Findlay wanted to comment on this.
I'm enjoying the discussion, but I've got a table in front of me that doesn't quite fit with what's being said, and it's taken from ASH, and it's pay gap for full-time earnings by age group in Scotland for 2016, and it tells me that for the 30 to 39 age group is the only age group in Scotland where women have a higher median income than men. Yet that doesn't really fit with our discussion about, you know, childcare responsibilities. So I'm trying to understand what's going on there. Do we understand it?
Professor Loretto.
Come in with my original point, but it does relate to that, and it's about age, and I think, you know, those figures will show the gender pay gap gets bigger, over time. And I think, can I just come in very briefly on the business case, and then I'll come to that point. I think an aspect of the business case that we're just now really waking up to, I'm doing some work currently for the Scottish Government, talking to a range of employers in Scotland as part of that work, and it's really the untapped potential of older women. So this has started to be picked up in some of the statistics, but I think really now have been picked up by employers as well. And actually, we heard earlier about the leaky pipeline. So, you know, ensuring that we keep women in the workforce for longer is a key part, you know, as we have ageing populations and keeping people in work for longer, and ensuring that we don't discriminate, that we keep those women in the workplace is going to become increasingly important. I think coming back to Jackie Bailey's query about the 30 to 39, I think partly that, other colleagues can come in here as well, but I think partly is the rising age in which people have children. And that is starting to see some of the motherhood penalty that comes in, discrimination around pregnancy and then coming back to work afterwards is kicking in slightly later. I think we are seeing now, some of the better educated women and, you know, that the gap closing in there. But certainly what is actually, I think, quite one of the most shocking things that is the gap still opens up after that, that we're not necessarily looking at a cohort issue. So that, you know, it'd be lovely to say that narrow gap, in fact, closing gap would continue as these people get older. But I think, unfortunately, that the signs are that the gaps open up because we do see discrimination coming in, particularly as a result of some of the, you know, the pressures that Irina raised earlier.
Sorry, Professor Findlay wanted to come in, I think, on the last point and perhaps on this
Probably both points. I think on the issue of age, we know that there is a variation by age. I mean, we know that there's some statistics for some years in which the 16 to 19-year-old group don't look very different. One of the issues about young workers is that they tend to be paid minimum wages, so the at the lowest pay decile, you also find one of the lowest pay, gender pay gaps, because the reality is that people have to be paid the national minimum wage, or now, well, at that age, still the national minimum wage, not the national living wage. So in that sense, that narrows the opportunity for a pay gap to emerge. Coming back to the question around recruitment practices, we did some work a few years ago for the Equalities and Human Rights Commission looking at the financial services sector. One of the things which was very interesting was how quickly the pay gap emerged for young women and men who entered the sector. So there was some variation at the beginning which reflected the issue around negotiation. A lot of the recruitment was informal, it was word of mouth, it was through networks, and people negotiated an individual salary rather than there being a graded salary which they were allocated to. Men tended to negotiate that salary at starting point much better than women did. And within 3 years, a gap had emerged across that cohort. So it very, very quickly started to emerge. And that means it's not necessarily connected, to come back to Jackie Bailey's point, it's not necessarily connected to the fact that people have children. It's just connected to the fact that they might.
So it's not age-related in that sense, or...?
It's age-related in different ways at different cohorts. So it does get bigger as career progresses. But I think that's not necessarily an age effect. It's a cumulative effect of the discrimination or the other factors that push the gender pay gap. Sorry, if I just say on the financial services sector, most women who the gender pay gap for bonuses rather than for hourly pay was 83%. And most women who took time out to have childcare lost their clients, lost their own portfolio of activities, and came back to much more lower salaries, but much lower bonuses.
Is that in London or UK-wide?
That was for the UK,
or
included Scotland, and significant responses from Scotland given the size of the Scottish financial services sector.
And do we have any breakdown of that for Scotland?
We do in the report, but I can send it to you.
Thank you. Jackie Bailey, you wanted to come back.
Yeah, I remain curious, and I don't think I've had an explanation in detail about why we have a position where actually for age 30 to 39, it works to our advantage, and it's nowhere else. And I genuinely don't think there's that many women age 40 and over having babies at that stage in life that would make such a huge difference to that pay gap. So if we know what's working there, and what's not working elsewhere, then surely we can spread the effect of it. So I'm curious as to why that just seems to be an outlier compared to the others.
I think Dr. Merkurieva wanted to come in on this.
I think one way to look at it is to check the profile of lifetime earnings. And in general, when we look at pay gap, it's important to understand what the split around is. And generally, the biggest gap is between the slow-skilled, female-dominated sector and the high-skilled, like top management, financial services, male-dominated sector. If you look at the life cycle profile of the top earners, you will find out that 30 to 39 is still the age of accumulation for this cohort. They peak much later. They would peak probably by their early 50s. And that's when they are going to overperform their female colleagues who did equally well at, let's say, mid-career posts between 30 and 39, but the females by the time would stay at the mid-career and the males will go away ahead. That's my view of one way of explaining these numbers. Yeah.
Okay. Right. I want to move on to a question from Andy Whiteman.
Thank you, convener. Mainly, perhaps for Professor Patricia Findlay, you advised the Fair Work Convention. I mean, to what extent is this a prominent issue within the work of the Convention?
It's a very prominent issue within the work of the Convention. One of the things that we have done from the outset and in constructing both the definition and the framework for Fair Work is to make sure that on every dimension that we look at, we analyse the existing evidence base by all of the protected characteristics. So if we were looking at the access to voice, for example, or the extent to which you get access to skills and training that provide fulfilling work, then we assessed all of that in terms of the evidence base by saying how does that affect people differently across the Scottish economy. And it's clearly the case that if you are likely to be disadvantaged on one area of Fair Work, as women often are, then that has impacts across other areas of Fair Work. And that doesn't just apply to women. So in the sense of how we constructed the framework and looked at the evidence, the idea of gender and other protected categories was immediately at the heart of that. in terms of the consultation which took place over the first year of the convention, where we spent a lot of time across the length and breadth of Scotland talking to people about their jobs and their experiences of fair work and their expectations, we had very significant representation from women in that, and we had particular concerns raised by older women, predominantly in the care sector and some, and in the banking and financial services sector, about some of their experiences at different parts of their life cycle. So it's a very prominent part of what we do. It's also a very prominent focus of the convention's current activities, because we're focusing on, at the moment, on the social care sector, which is predominantly occupied by women, and we're focusing on the particular experience of older women. So it's very central to what we're interested in.
And are you confident that this work is going to lead to change?
I think the last time I appeared at this committee, I've been very clear that it's the job of the Fair Work Convention is to do what it can to act as a catalyst for change. But there are many players in this landscape, and that change would have to be driven by a multiplicity of players. It includes government, it includes employers, it includes campaigning organisations, it includes trade unions. So there are a variety of places in which we might improve the experience of women in the Scottish economy, but that's a very complex and broad ecosystem or landscape. But we would hope to, because otherwise, why would we try?
Richard Leonard.
I've got a question about the gender bias as it affects women as workers, and whether you could share with us any research that you've done or any reports you've published on, first of all, the impact of a sustained period of public expenditure restraint, how that's affected the position of women in the workplace, both in the public and the private sector. And secondly, looking forward, how do you anticipate, and have you done any work on the expected impact on women workers of automation?
Professor Loretto, perhaps first, and then Emily Thomson.
I can't comment on the second part, but on the first, I think this is the relationship with care and unpaid work, more generally unpaid work. And I think in terms of particularly, again, if my own area, looking at over the life course and towards later life working, one big area is grandparenting. And the number of older men and older women who are caring for grandchildren in order to let their usually daughters enter the economy. So I think there's an intergenerational transfer here that is pulling older women, but also some older men, out of work earlier than they might have otherwise done so, in order to be able to let their, and it is predominantly to let their daughters work, and to younger women work. So I think that is quite a big effect, noticing I'm doing a couple of projects in this at the moment, and I think that is going to have quite renowned implications for future working amongst women of all ages.
Again, it's on the first point rather than the second. So the public sector spending restraint in the wake of the Great Recession has really impacted on women in two ways, I think, as workers within the public sector, so they're overrepresented as public sector workers, and as service users, so where we see cuts to local services, particularly in terms of social care. So if social care is being defunded or has less funding available, that care still needs to be done. And we have a little bit of evidence that it's going out into the informal care sector, as Wendy's pointed out. So people still need to be cared for, elderly parents still need to be cared for, but when the state isn't there to do that work, it goes out to women who are doing it on an unpaid basis. And we don't really know very much about what goes on in the household in terms of unpaid work and unpaid productive work. But the ONS published the household satellite accounts for the first time in 10 years in October of last year, which showed that childcare and elderly care was the biggest component of the unpaid work that was being done within households, and that had increased in the wake of the recession. And it's not that the number of carees, if you like, people being cared for, had increased. It was that the hours that was being done had increased. So I think that the impact has been to kind of move some of that caring work out from the paid economy and into the informal unpaid economy, and that has impacted more on women because of structural expectations around who will do that care.
Thank you. I was going to move on to Ash Denham.
My question is about how we alter the occupational segregation landscape in Scotland. So women choosing or being funneled into certain types of work. And I know that Emily Thomson has undertaken some work on the modern apprenticeship gender split. So I'd be interested to hear about that work as well.
Yeah, absolutely. So we've been working on gender and modern apprenticeships for some time now. The first was the Equal Opportunities Commission's general formal investigation into segregation and training work, which published in 2005. So, yeah, I mean, the modern apprenticeship programme is publicly funded and as such has a real opportunity to kind of impact on gender segregation. But what we see is that the traditional apprenticeships, so the areas like engineering, construction, manufacturing, where the notion of apprenticeship training is much more embedded rather than the kind of non-traditional, more service sector based apprenticeships. And of course, that was the whole idea about modern apprenticeships. They were modern because they were in the more prevalent sectors as the economy sort of restructured. There's a real difference in terms of the quality of training that was being offered in those two different splits. And we had some limited evidence, or we have had some limited evidence as time has gone by, around the pay gap in apprenticeships was really very large. So the female-dominated areas were being paid much, much less and had much less returns on that human capital investment than the traditional sectors had, engineering, construction, etc., etc. And it seems to be, I think Emma Ritch described it as totemic, as a totemic issue of the modern apprenticeships, because we have so much evidence around what the issues are in terms of occupational segregation within that, and because it's publicly funded, we could, you know, really take some steps towards change within that sector. And I think the issue around procurement that Chris Oswald from the EHRC had mentioned earlier on is perhaps a key lever within that issue. But in the time that I've been working on modern apprenticeships, which has been a good sort of 10 to 12 years, the representation of women in those traditional frameworks has really not shifted at all.
In years, it hasn't shifted?
No. There's been very, very little progress. We have seen a massive expansion of social care apprenticeships.
I'm sure.
But there's very, very low male representation within those apprenticeships as well. So I think that's definitely part of the issue. We see more work being done to get women into the traditional areas, but less being done to get men into the non-traditional areas. It can often be a hard sell because they're generally quite low paid as well. So there are lots of intractable issues within that. But it's an area that we could really make a difference, I think. Thank you.
Yes, Professor Loretto.
Just as a very brief adjunct point to that, I think one of the areas we haven't spoken about is women in self-employment, because that's an increasing area. And what we do know is that women in self-employment are much lower paid. So in terms of the gender pay gap, that is a big area that really is requiring some exploration. It perhaps links back to automation. You know, why do people, you know, leave employment and take up self-employment? Are they, you know, been driven out? How much of a conscious choice is it? And I think that's an area that would be really helpful for the committee to do a bit more investigation of.
Yes, Professor Findlay.
I think there's some, coming back to modern apprenticeships, there's been some work done around, we did some work a few years ago in the manufacturing subcluster in Scotland, and it's partly about, as Emily says, access to modern apprenticeships and the terms on which you get that access. But there's also a really important issue about the level, the qualifications level of modern apprenticeships. So if you look at manufacturing in Scotland, we find that women are less likely to undertake modern apprenticeships, and even when they undertake them, they will be at a lower level. And part of that will be that not just that women are being offered a lower level apprenticeship, but they are in the lower paying parts of the manufacturing subsector. So, for example, they're in food production. So I think it's not just about getting the same number of women into apprenticeships, challenging though that undoubtedly is, but it's about making sure that those apprenticeships, because as we know, the qualifications framework spreads quite high now, making sure that women get access to apprenticeships that are at a comparable level.
I'm just wondering, and then we'll come to Emily Thomson, the point mentioned about self-employment, as someone who has been self-employed myself, does not personal choice come into some of this? I mean, it does get rather complex, doesn't it? Because as a self-employed person, you're making decisions about all sorts of things in a business context. And I'm just wondering, as well as paid employment, how much that can come in and influence or affect things. I think we've touched on some of that already. But
points there, just to make the committee aware of work that's being carried out at Heria Watt, led by Professor Mike Danson, around poverty and self-employment. The early findings that are coming out from that work and that research is that there is an element of free choice, yes, but in the wake of the structural changes to the welfare system, what we're seeing is not necessarily an move towards entrepreneurialism or an entrepreneurial spirit. It's survival strategies. It's people that are trying to scratch a living when they have perhaps been sanctioned. And that has a gender dimension because the issues around lone parenthood come into play there as well. So we must recognise that people do have free will and they do have free choice, but those choices are being made under conditions of considerable constraint, and the interaction of the welfare system with paid labour markets is one of them. And the other issue is, I think that the ASH data that we have around pay will not reflect earnings from self-employment, so we don't really know what those issues are around how much people are earning when they undertake self-employment. So I gave evidence to a committee inquiry into underemployment, I think it was in 2013, that was looking at this issue, and 60% of the new businesses that had been set up in the wake of the recession were female-owned businesses. But again, they were very, very low paid and they were not earning enough to pay tax, which has an impact on the tax revenues available to Scotland as well. So there is a lot of work to be done around that, I think.
And you mentioned tax. Tax is part of the equation in terms of how much a person pays in tax. Presumably, is that taken account of when we look at these figures that we're considering in terms of the gender pay gap? The actual tax burden paid by the individual? Are we just looking at gross income figures?
No, I think the ASH is based on HMRC data, as Trisha Findlay had outlined earlier on. You might have a more detailed...
It's based on gross earnings, and there's no difference in the taxation profiles of men and women in that sense, so your personal allowances are the same. So it looks at gross earnings.
Right, thank you. And Dr. Merkurieva.
I think if we want to supplement the knowledge of self-employment, we can rely to some extent on household surveys that would have a measure of earnings for both self-employed and employees, and the evidence is quite clear. I would probably parallel the developments in self-employment to what we have discussed about part-time and full-time employment. So the differences are exactly the same. They are very polarized. And you can think of it as there can be self-employment and there can be part-time employment that is a coping strategy. So once a person was displaced because of automation or anything else, well, you come up with alternative pathways. Or you can think of kind of similar looking on paper, part-time employment and self-employment as an income effect. So an older worker who has enough income to cut down on hours and open a business, like think of a high-level consultancy or something, right, to enjoy the work rather than cope with the difficulties. And so in both part-time and self-employment, we have these two poles.
Mm-hmm. I think Gil Patterson wanted to come in with a question, then Professor Loretto. Professor Loretto would comment first, and then we'll come back to Gil's point.
It's the same subject.
It is, yes. It's just to pick up on the choice that you mentioned, Chair. And I think this is, you know, it's really important to say that you know, choice and the opportunity for choice is very gendered, particularly when we look at when people lose their jobs slightly later on. So I'm talking here about over 50s, and we do have evidence that women find it particularly difficult to, both men and women find it difficult to get back into employment, but women do face additional challenges of that intersection between ageism and sexism, and going on then to take up self-employment, you know, it is a choice, but it's a choice that is very severely constrained. I think also, given the partial evidence that we do have at the moment, there is a question to the extent to which self-employment is actually disguised unemployment, that in some cases, again, I'm talking here about the over 50s, it can be a face-saving measure. So actually looking at the hours that that people do, they're very small, they're very it's very, you know, partial work. So there's a huge underemployment issue here as well. And that indeed is gendered from what we can find.
And further to that, is there any evidence to suggest that some sectors are, people have been encouraged to be self-employed, so there's less liability on the real employer? In other words, you know, the job is available, but only for self-employed people, but in a contractual basis.
Professor Findlay.
There are undoubtedly the development of business models in particular places which rely on a much more distanced workforce, and that's a development we've seen over a number of years. So for the classic example which people cite is couriers. Most couriers are not directly employed, they're self-employed, and they're subject to quite challenging contractual arrangements with the companies that they contract for. So in that sense, I think it picks up on Wendy's point. There's an issue around, I suppose what you're referring to is kind of bogus self-employment. There's an issue around whether self-employment masks underemployment. So the issue about why people end up in self-employment and what it produces is a complex one, but we do know that the gender pay gap persists, and we do know that the issue about women who are self-employed work fewer hours in self-employment than men. So we know that there are different choices being made, but again, I always like to think about choices as being places that people are make a choice on a normal distribution. We wouldn't expect to see differences across the genders. Okay. If we're seeing them, we're seeing them for a reason.
Julian Martin wanted to come back in there.
Supplementary, and following on from this, presumably people who are kind of almost forced into self-employment are less likely to actually have pensions, pension contributions as well. So effectively, are we storing up a problem of elderly poverty for women because of this as well?
I think we could be, you know, and I think part of my point is we don't have the good systematic evidence. I think we are storing up a problem in all employed, you know, all women, and increasing pensioner poverty for women if we don't address the gender pay gap, because this issue is, as I said earlier, is very much an employment. The self-employed are still a relatively small number in terms of the whole labour force. That's not to say they aren't important, they are, but I think this issue about storing up problems for pensioner poverty affect everything employed and self-employed.
Okay. John Mason.
Thanks, convener. I mean, if I could start off with something Emily Thomson said, which was referring to the idea of getting men into sectors where they're not traditionally been, and that maybe that's not very worthwhile if it's low paid anyway. But I just want, that's not exactly what he said, I'm just slightly being provocative as usual. Based on what we said before, I mean, maybe getting more men into nursery care, for example, would strengthen the argument to pay nursery workers better, though maybe that's not the way it should be done. I mean, is that something we should be aiming at? Is it something that's important? I mean, does it actually matter that, you know, nursery, kids in nursery and childcare have male role models, all that kind of thing? And I suppose that goes right into primary school, that's an area dominated by women teachers. So there's the kind of financial question, but there's also the kind of wider question, is that inherently a good thing or a bad thing?
Yeah, I'll just respond to that. I think it is a very worthwhile thing to try and do, because I think that the more men that we see in the traditional female-dominated caring-type roles will help us to break that ideological link between women equals care or female caregiver. And I think that seems to me to be at the crux of quite a lot of the arguments that we've heard around childcare, for example, around the unpaid work that underpins women's inequality in the labour market in a wider sense. It is a low-paid sector because the market tends to devalue or undervalue work that is dominated by women, because the skills that are needed to be a childcare worker or a nursery worker are seen to be somehow naturally endowed to women by dint of their biological characteristics. So the market doesn't reward them in the same way. And I think that it's very important that we try and increase the male representation in female-dominated areas. And I think that would help to increase the wages in those sectors. And yes, primary school teaching is dominated by women. Classroom assistants are overwhelmingly women in some of the lowest paid jobs in our economy. But even within the female dominated primary school teaching, we see many, many more male head teachers. So even though the workforce overall is dominated by women, we see a male over-representation at the higher areas of that. And I think that's incredibly important to try and increase the representation of men within female-dominated areas in our economy.
I mean, is there also a problem here that society treats a lot of men with suspicion if they are interested in working with childcare? Or...
Yeah, that's very true. When we did our original work on modern apprenticeships, we couldn't get any male childcare apprentices to talk to us as part of our research. And there was only, I think, two or three in Scotland at the time. I think now there's more. I think there's roughly around 100. I might not be 100% sure in childcare apprenticeships in the economy at the moment. But there is definitely that purchaser barrier to having men working in nurseries that generally the employers were reporting that parents didn't like it, that parents were suspicious of men working in nurseries and in childcare. And I think that's incredibly sad. And I think we could do something about that if we had a concerted effort to increase the numbers of men that were working in childcare, because it's good for children as well and their development in terms of role models to challenge that gendered expectation that women are the only ones that do the caring in the economy and do the caring in society in a wider sense. So I do think it's incredibly important, but there is a lot of work to do.
Okay, thanks. And somebody else on that point? Okay. I think.
Professor Findlay.
Yeah, could I just pick up on two points arising from what Emily said? If you look at the category of nursery nurses and assistants on the most recent statistical data, you'll find that there's a gender pay gap of 4.5% in the UK in an industry or an occupation, where women hold 98% of the jobs. So even in something that's completely dominated by women, you've still got a gender pay gap of 4.5%, which translates into salaries of 15,286 for men and 12,000 for women. That's still a really significant gap in a sector which women dominate. I think that takes us back to the issue of segregation. Horizontal segregation is probably playing a role in that. But it also takes us back to the issue of poverty. So one of the single things that we could do, which is to reduce the gender pay gap, is to reduce low pay. If we look at the low-paid workforce in the UK, women make up 60% of the low-paid workforce. If we look at Scotland, 20% of women earn less than the living wage compared with 14% of men. So actually, not just tackling the gender pay gap directly, but tackling some issues of low pay would automatically impact on the gender pay gap. And we saw that because we saw the introduction of the national minimum wage having the biggest impact in any year on the size of the gender pay gap in the UK. So in those occupations, it's not just about tackling segregation and the gender pay gap, it's about tackling poverty, wages.
And if I could switch to the kind of academic, the other end, the universities and things, is there discrimination there? I mean, obviously here at this panel we have more women than men, but overall in the universities, I think we had some research from Yale, I think it was, that suggested there was bias against women in the academic world.
Professor Wall.
Yeah, I think the Yale research is really very interesting. Briefly, job applications were sent to senior people who appointed jobs, male and female, identical, the same jobs, just different names. The outcome, and this was thought to be a true, this wasn't an experiment. I mean, the people who were doing it thought it was all real. And the outcome was that less women than men got offered jobs. I mean, it was worse than that. Those women who did get offered jobs were offered less money in the first instance and less mentoring. So you see the picture right from the very beginning. It's not even though that the two-thirds, one-third enter on equality. They're already the women are below and they're giving less support both in income and in mentoring before they've even started working. And if you look at the bigger pictures for academia in general, there are graphs in the most recent STEMEC report of last year to the Scottish Government. It starts with women, as we've discussed earlier, being 50% or more in a large number of disciplines, and they just slowly fall off the edge. So the higher you get up the tree, the less there are, and it becomes self-reinforcing. So we haven't touched yet on the question of institutional sexism. Because this, I mean, academia particularly is an area where the questions of sexual discrimination have been discussed at some time. All the employers are completely committed to fairness and all the rest of it. And yet, nevertheless, we still see this happening. So there are institutional structures here and behaviours that are encouraged and supported by the institutions that bring it about. And these need to be tackled in a strategic way. Inside academia, the Royal Society of Edinburgh produced the Tapping All Our Talents report in 2012. Now, that was adopted by the Scottish Government, but it might be interesting for the committee to explore how the government has taken this forward in a different way. There were three committees that were given different parts of task. We won't go into the detail. But I think it'd be very instructive to see how far the Scottish government has taken in either adopting itself or encouraging the organisations it funds to take on the proposals inside Tapping All Our Talents.
I think academia is illustrative of some of the hidden reasons for the gender pay gap, where you have a system of reward that's very much based on the individual performance, which ostensibly at face value seem to be fair. You know, you're rewarding the individual for their performance, their attributes, etc. But actually can really hide the fact, as we heard earlier, that women may be rewarded for rather different behaviours from men. And I think some of the issues of tackling these hidden reasons for the gender pay gap, I think, come to light through academia. One classic one is international mobility, for example, whether that be being able to travel internationally, the number of conferences, visiting professorships, or indeed just mobility to shift between jobs to drive up pay. And, you know, that is obviously very gendered, and I think that is really just now starting to be tackled in academia, I think, as we see more women come into senior roles. So, you know, that I think that's very, very key in number, both in tackling institutionalised prejudice and discrimination, but also enabling different pathways to be opened up as well. I think so. Academia is a bit of a lens, for other systems that have that system of reward and promotion as well.
I mean, you said that it's beginning to be tackled. So, if we just give it a bit of time, is it going to work itself out?
No. I think that's the issue. And as we've heard more generally about having, encouraging more women and enabling more women, not just encouraging, but enabling more women to get into these positions, enabling the voices to be heard. So, I mean, this committee is incredibly welcome for that, because it's enabling these voices, enabling the research to be heard, and enabling indirectly the voices of women who are, not coming along to committees, such as the low paid, low skill that we've heard about, but other ways in which their voices can be heard more directly, not just indirectly through us here, I think it's important. So thinking about trade unions, other bodies as well that represent these women directly.
Dr. Merkurieva.
Generally, academia provides numerous case studies that illustrate many of the gender issues. And so in economics, the Royal Economic Society has a committee on women that follows up the data on economic faculty in the United Kingdom, and generally the conclusions are that even after completing a PhD, there is this still the leaky pipe, so women don't make it to the professorship. Moreover, we have a number of examples of what would seem to be obvious good solutions that did not work. And one example that did not work, in the United States, which are particularly bad in terms of maternity leaves, numerous universities introduced equal right to extend tenure track for male and female faculty, which was a great move in equality. After several years of observing the outcomes, it turned out that actually this equality move had a negative effect on the achievement gap. So women ended up being in a worse position than men. Generally, the reason is that for each child that was born over the tenure track, you would get one extra year to get your publications done. Men managed to use this extra year, or several years if there are numerous children, to their advantage. Women had to use these years while taking care of the kids and then facing the same previously available reduced tenure track period. And so kind of a well-intentioned move that is totally welcome in terms of equality ends up not playing a role in achievement and pay gaps. So.
Professor Findlay, and I think Professor Wilson.
Can I make two very quick points, which I think draw on the experience within academia, but also are pertinent to broader professional work? So one of the, there's quite an interesting American Economics Review paper which looks at the allocation of tasks within academia to men and women differentially. And one of the issues which arises is that women are more likely to take on those tasks which are less visible and less measurable. They might be very, very important to the quality of our students' experience or the type of research that we undertake or the institutional maintenance of our organisations, but they tend to be less visible and less the things that are counted when it comes to promotion. And that's also the case in financial services. So revenue-generating functions rather than other kinds of supports or institutional functions are allocated differently across the sexes. And that's about the operation of who does what in the workplace. I think there's a second issue which is around, particularly for professional and managerial workers in the UK, which is around work intensification and particularly work-to-life spillover. So if we look across Europe post the global financial crisis, actually work intensification lowered in most countries and for many occupations. If we look in the UK, it increased, and it increased particularly for professional and managerial workers. So if you're a higher level professional worker, your work-to-life spillover is now higher than it was before, and that's a disincentive for women to enter into higher level professional occupations or managerial occupations. Those jobs have become more demanding, they take up more time, they're now more amorphous, partly by the use of technology, and that makes it much more difficult to deal with the sort of work-life balance issues which people talked about earlier.
I'm just wondering, the last question about if you take steps to try to address something, sometimes it has, I think, the opposite effect, which is what Dr. Merkurieva was talking about. And going back to something Emily Thomson said about care workers, we heard evidence in another inquiry from the care sector, and there was evidence of the effect that the sector is something that is not as highly valued as it ought to. And I'm not talking about money terms, but actually the work that's done. And partly we were told there's a social attitude problem, and that's why there's not enough people even going into it. So I'm just wondering if, looking at the issue we're addressing now, that's part of the problem. When we say undervalued, is it just about the pay and the money, or is part of the root problem going back to the types of career that people socially value or rate in terms other than money? Is that part of it? I just wonder, Emily Thomson, if you had any comment on that.
Yeah, I mean, I think there's almost a kind of a dilemma there, that there is many jobs in the economy whose value is more social or spiritual, or is around children's development, for example, but doesn't mean to say that those jobs shouldn't be remunerated in terms of money at the same time. And I think it boils down to, as well, it's not just about the paid jobs, it's about the unpaid jobs that we... So our gross domestic product figures, for example, don't tell us anything about the distribution of who does unpaid caring roles within the economy, and I think that that's really something that has to address. But our value system is very much marketised, and there does need to be a challenge to that, I think. But at the same time, it's not fair that the people that engage in care work are living on poverty wages. There's a social justice issue there. So I think there's kind of a conundrum there. There's a bit of a dilemma around saying yes, that there's many, many jobs whose value is more than can be expressed in market terms, but at the same time, there's a justice issue there around the distribution of those jobs and those roles. And I'm not sure how we get around that.
Okay, thank you. Gordon MacDonald.
Thanks, Camino. Scotland's median pay gap is 15.6, and its mean pay gap is 14.9. Is there any countries of a similar size to Scotland that has better figures than that that we could be looking at to see how they have closed their attainment gap?
Professor Findlay, first of all?
The Scandinavian countries have lower pay gaps. I mean, there's lots of international comparative work done around pay gaps. Mm. I came in on the end of the discussion this morning when people were talking about whether or not that reflected a cultural issue in other countries, particularly the Scandinavian countries. I would very strongly advocate that it reflects institutional approaches. So people raised the issue of childcare this morning, issues about ensuring that access to the supply routes into different kinds of work are more appropriately dealt with in terms of gender. I think there are issues about access to training and development. There are issues around access to voice, which are much more characteristic of those economies. So we know that with the gender pay gap is lower in organisations, for example, where a trade union is present. And we know that those economies are much more have much more systematic forms of voice. So there are institutional features in other countries which can reduce that lower pay gap. One of the things which somebody quoted Iceland this morning, I think it might have been yourself, one of the things which Iceland did for a very long time, up until a few years before the global financial crisis, was it published everybody's salary. And there's a huge issue in this area around transparency and what people know. So you might look at aggregate figures about the gender pay gap, but you don't know what it is for your occupation. And even if you know what it is for your occupation, you don't know what it is within your own organisation, and it's not easy to find out. So transparency in a public level or an organisational level is one of the institutional factors that can really support people understanding whether or not they've been discriminated against, understanding whether or not there is a gap. Now, there's a long step between that and having a remedy. So you have to be able to know about your problem. You have to be able to affect that remedy. And there are real challenges around that currently in Scotland and the rest of the UK. But some of those institutional features of other countries are things that we could learn a lot from. And we could understand how that might impact on reducing the gender pay gap in Scotland.
You mentioned Scandinavia. I just need to be clear on this point. I'm looking at the PwC Women in Work Index. And the top three countries are Iceland, Sweden and Norway. The median pay gap between female and male, 16% in Iceland, 14% in Sweden and 15% in Norway. And if my understanding is correct, Scotland's median pay gap is 15.6.
Those are close enough for there to be issues about statistical variation. It's also been different over time. But those are the economies that people tend to talk about as having lower pay gaps.
Right. Okay.
I think Professor Wall wanted to come in on this point, sorry.
At the end of the last session, convener, you asked what could be done in some respects. And one of the things that, I mean, one of the very powerful tools the Scottish Government has, of course, is the procurement policy. So although there are a good deal of sophistication, I mean, this is at one level crude, but there's no reason why the government policy shouldn't be to say that firms cannot win public jobs if their gender pay gap is bigger than a certain amount, and announce at the same time that over a period of time that is going to be reduced figures. So if it's 15% at the moment, it will be 14% in 2 years' time, 12% in 5 years. What, you know, I mean, you can argue about the figures. But the point is, once you start a trajectory like that, actually it begins to get, becomes to some degree not self-fulfilling, but it becomes much easier to get going. But it comes back to the point I made earlier about the experience of Athena Swan. I mean, the discussions we're having have been had for decades in my own personal experience. At some point, someone has to say enough is enough, and we're going to start legislating or structuring the way we operate our systems to ensure that it doesn't happen. And so I offer that as one, you know, practical possibility the committee could explore.
Is there any countries that have introduced legislation of that nature regarding procurement, or is there any other best practice across the world that we could be looking at to try and close the attainment gap, the gender pay gap?
I myself am not aware of that, but I'm sure my colleagues could identify some out with this meeting.
One question, Professor Wall, on that point. Would it not depend on EU procurement rules as well, which might cause slight difficulty in taking that approach, at least at present?
I don't have the expertise to say, but in my experience, you can always find a lawyer who will find your solution to write it in the way you want. I'm quite serious about that. I've done lots of procurement for most of my professional career. If you want to get an objective, there's a way to get it. You just have to find out how to draft it.
I suppose that may be a problem in the area we're involved in here. I think Professor Findlay wanted to come in. Sorry, beg your pardon. Professor Wilson and then Professor Findlay.
Yeah, I just wanted to say that I have a report here on closing the pay gap and what other European countries have done. But I'd also like to pick up the point that Professor Wall makes about, well, what are we going to do? You know, what can the Scottish government do? And, you know, in the news recently, there's been talk about naming and shaming 139 companies who haven't been paying the minimum national wage. Never very sure about that terminology, Tricia, will keep me right about it. But, you know, these companies, 139, have been named and shamed. And it turns out that the HRMC are collecting the data, which allows them to know what, you know, what companies are failing to provide the minimum wage. And, you know, the data presumably can relatively easily be collected on pay gaps as well, and then fines imposed. So there are ways for, there are a number of different ways forward in order to make sure that this gap is closed, and that it isn't just simply a case of, you know, making companies more accountable and then just leaving it at that, which is very much the case at the moment.
Professor Findlay.
Yeah, if I pick up on the procurement issue, the current Scottish procurement regulations do allow for an equality clause, so there is an equality element in procurement. That's a very far step away from understanding how people perceive and operate in relation to those guidelines. So, for example, there is also a commitment to fair work in the current procurement guidelines, but we don't know an awful lot, and we're trying to get behind how people operationalise that. So does that really make a difference? Now, it may be that you can push that a lot further than perhaps the Scottish Government are comfortable with. It's clear from the European regulations that, for example, it's not appropriate to say you have to pay the living wage in a contract that's secured under European procurement rules. So there are some areas, there's some grey areas, but there are some areas which are very clear that you can't use procurement to address. But I think that's an area that you could explore thinking about how not just procurement, but support, business support services might also be ways in which you would encourage people to address issues around the gender pay gap. Coming back to the naming and shaming, as a convention, we talked a lot about the issue of naming and shaming. It's a challenging one. It's used by the HMRC in relation to the national minimum wage. And that's available because you can find particular example. So, for example, ASH wouldn't give you the composition of a business's gender pay gap. Part of the challenge is that for individual businesses, they're sometimes not necessarily good at calculating or understanding what their own gender pay gap is. So, therefore, I think that's a first step. There are lots of services out there from ACAS and the Equality and Human Rights Commission, and I'm sure any university that you would want to chat to will send you a researcher who'll come and calculate your gender pay gap. But lots of businesses find it very, very challenging when they've got complex grading structures and different pay arrangements to actually understand how much of a pay gap they've really got.
Thank you. And Andy Whiteman.
Yes, thank you. I was interested in Emily Thompson's comment about care workers being paid less because there's a perception that their biological characteristics lend themselves to that work, therefore they deserve less. I mean, men working in physical manual work, the same attitude's not taken, generally speaking. And we talk about the gender pay gap, we often talk about why women are paid less. We tend to talk less about why men are paid too much. And I'm just wondering to what extent this is fundamentally about patriarchy.
Well, Emily Thompson, Professor Findlay, Professor Loretto, I think we have a few interested parties, so carry on.
Yes, I think it is. And I think that patriarchy interacts with markets and how they value certain skills and jobs. I think that job evaluation schemes within organisations can be subject to gender bias, and some of these assumptions are very, very entrenched in people's psyche. And in our kind of collective psyche as well, that I'm not sure where we go from that, but I think that at least kind of trying to talk about caring responsibility and caring roles as being skilled in the same way that we might talk about manual labour, for example. I've never really thought about male-dominated roles being overpaid, but I suppose that is a potential. And in terms of the gender pay gap, if we look at individual organisations and look at their pay gaps, I think, yes, that's kind of part of the story, but looking at horizontal and vertical segregation as well is really important in trying to understand these gaps. we haven't said the other word, which I think is feminist, a feminist analysis of these economic issues. And I think that that would recognise that patriarchy has something to do with these structural issues. So, yeah.
Professor Findlay.
I suppose the short answer is yes, of course, it's about patriarchy. That, in a sense, doesn't necessarily take us terribly far. It doesn't take us to something that we can action. As Emily's quite rightly said, patriarchy interacts with markets and organisational factors, so there's a complex interplay between those things. I don't think we should get ourselves in the position where we're saying, oh, is it the fact that male manual workers are overpaid? The fact that there are pay disparities and differences of pay evaluation across different categories of workers doesn't necessarily lead you to that conclusion. It is undoubtedly the case that some of the arguments we have around the gender pay gap and gender disparities detracts from some of the challenges that face other people in the economy. So we talk, for example, a lot about women's boardroom representation. That's probably not of great interest to many people at the lower end of the occupational spectrum, male or female. So we've got complex intersecting factors here, and I don't think we need to... We don't have to have a binary approach whereby we say if care workers are being paid too little, male manual workers are being paid too much. I don't think that takes us further forward. But yes, I think it is about patriarchy and markets.
Professor Loretto.
Very much agree with the colleagues, but I won't come in on that. Just another point, saying the current work the Scottish Government mentioned, talking to some employers in the care sector, and obviously there is a key shortage of employees in that sector, and there's going to be an increasing demand for more people in that sector. And actually, the employers we're speaking to that have paid are now paying the living wage have seen an increase in the number of men coming in to take up positions. So it is part of that, you know, the business case that we heard earlier in it being able to release that capacity.
Professor Findlay, I think, did you want to come in on this one?
Fine.
No, fair enough. Fine. Sorry, beg your pardon, Dr.
I was just wondering
Merkurieva.
In terms of where do we, so trying to make a bit of a step, where do we go from there after we all agree on the issue? And I think part of it is a matter of opportunity. So if you take a low-paid job, the question is, well, okay, if you don't take it, what do you do next? And we see that it's easier for males to move to a female-dominated sector, let's say care, rather than the other way around. So it comes back to education and to expansion of the opportunities that female low-paid workers have to walk out of these arrangements.
Bill Bowman.
Can I go back to a question or an answer that came earlier? I thought it was quite interesting when we were talking about the self-employed. And we said we had no information at all on entrepreneurial differences between male and female as to how they may or may not contribute to whether it's earnings or GDP. Is that the case?
Professor Loretto.
It's not that there's no information, sorry, misled, that is actually that there's much more limited, and in terms of the systematic, and as we've talked earlier about the sources of information on pay that comes from employed, we don't have that similar information on self-employed, so we are relying on self-report data, meaning from Labour Force Survey and other similar sources, and so it's much more unreliable.
But is there something you could say?
There is, and the problem with those surveys, and we heard this earlier as well, when you start to try and break down, you know, even to get Scottish figures, for example, out of the whole of UK, it starts to become quite unreliable. So breaking down in terms of sector, then by gender, etc., the numbers just are not big enough at the moment to be able to do that analysis.
Any other comment on that from any of our guests? No? Fair enough. Could I go back to something, Professor Findlay, that I think you had mentioned, at least in passing? I think you referred to protected characteristics. Were you referring to the Equality Act definition? What I wanted to perhaps ask was the following, and how this may fit into the Fair Work Convention or the work that you do, and what your comment might be on this. The one approach to trying to assist women in the workplace is to have childcare provision to enable them to return to work at a point that they consider appropriate. But if we look at the protected characteristics, religion, for example, is one of the protected characteristics. So some women from a number of religions may feel or choose, because of their religious beliefs, that they should look after their children to a certain age, whether it's 2, whether it's 5. Others may not, even from the same religion. People have different viewpoints. But I'm just wondering, for women who make that choice to take a certain amount of time out before resuming their career, childcare provision will not assist them. So I'm just wondering how that fits into the puzzle. I mean, it may be more about the returning to work element and how they're brought back into the work stream rather than the reason why they choose to make the choices they do.
Okay, I'm not sure that there is much evidence that suggests there are big religious variations in that. I think that there are undoubtedly broader cultural and family structure factors mm-hmm. which impact on whether or not women are more or less likely to return to work. Part of the issue is around what is available to women in terms of maternity leave. So if you have a long period of funded maternity leave, then the chances of you... the length of time of that funded maternity leave is very different across different countries, and therefore you might be more likely to return back. Quality childcare, I think, is part of the answer, but it's not the only answer. Because it doesn't take into account the fact that people will make, men and women, parents of all kinds, will make different choices about their relationship to market and non-market activities. So part of what I think we need to do is we need to have childcare that allows women to engage appropriately in the labour market where they choose to and in the form that they choose to. But we also need to have a labour market and organisations specifically that are catered to the needs of families and not the other way around. I tend to worry that we have a debate in Scotland particularly where we focus very much on childcare, and I don't want to underestimate how important I think good, high-quality childcare is in supporting parents to go back to work, and also in supporting children's life chances. But I do think that we have to see that as being a sort of dynamic relationship. We want families to be able to respond through childcare to what the labour market and organisation needs, but we want organisations to respond to what individuals and families need. It's not at all about change in the one direction. Mm-hmm. So issues around flexible working, issues around the type of maternity leave, issues around ensuring that work is not so overbearing that people can't balance it with family life, they are as important in my view. What happens, coming back to the earlier question from Jill, what happens in that workplace is as important as the availability of childcare. These are supply and demand factors which need to be looked at interactively.
And just wondering, it's perhaps a broader issue, this, but are there other countries that we can compare Scotland to of a similar size and how they approach these sorts of issues that we could learn from?
I don't have anything. I mean, I can have a think about it. I don't have anything to hand in terms of what countries present. We know countries that we don't want to compare ourselves with. So we know that in the US, the experience of women at work is much more challenging in terms of, for example, things like paid maternity leave. And again, there are kind of usual suspects countries where we can say you get a 2-year maternity leave in Sweden, but you don't get that in Scotland, or you certainly don't get 2 years paid maternity leave. That's quite significant because that might reflect different time periods in which people will be willing to leave their children. Mm-hmm. But I think that there's lots of different configurations there. In and of itself, part-time work doesn't have to be a problem. I suppose it comes back to the issue that was partly raised in relation to digital working earlier. There's no reason why working part-time and combining work and family life should be as disadvantageous as it is. I think many of us might want to work fewer hours and spend a bit more time at home. But the choices are constrained by the fact that the options available for part-time work and how that part-time work takes place in practice does impose a detriment on part-time workers in general, but particularly on women as the vast majority of part-time workers. So there's no reason we couldn't change that to make that different.
Thank you. I think Professor Loretto wanted to come in on this.
Yes, just asking about countries, and actually Norway is interesting, and this came for the Centre for Senior Politics, so actually not a gender a source, but actually age and keeping people in work for longer, and actually thinking about a life course approach to say, you know, actually if you allow people to work more flexibly at earlier stages in their life, or indeed as Tricia was saying, you know, attention's given to the work-life balance and spillover throughout the life course, actually you don't tire people out and keep people in the workforce for longer, and again there's particular gender aspect to this is keeping women in the workforce for longer than they currently do, because they still do retire earlier than men, despite increased life expectancy and healthy life expectancy.
Okay, I think John Mason had a follow-up
supplementary
question.
To what Professor Findlay just said. I mean, how do we deal with that then if part-time people are being paid less well than full-time? I mean, should there be legislation on that, that you have to pay the same for every hour, whether the person's full-time or part-time?
Well, there is. So there is part-time workers regulations which require you to pay the same for part-time work. The issue is less about the hours on the job and much more about what are the opportunities for work that are available on a part-time basis. So that's about defining which work is capable of being undertaken part-time and also the opportunities that are available to part-time workers. So part-time workers, for example, are less likely to get access to training opportunities. They're less likely to get to career development. They're less likely to be promoted. So there are lots of sectors in which part-time working is, if you look at the retail sector, part-time working is very common. And we know that lots of people work part-time in the retail sector in order to be able to balance work and family life. But when you start to move into promoted posts, team leaders, first-line managers posts, they're much less likely to be part-time. Now, is there any particular reason why that's the case? You can't see on the face of it that the nature of the work requires it to be done full-time. In fact, for lots of work, it's very difficult to see why it can't be done full-time. But it's about the opportunities that are available for high-quality work on a part-time basis. And maybe then women and men could equally opt to engage in part-time work.
Okay. Follow-up, I think, from Dean Lockhart.
Thank you, convener. It was on this point about helping women return to work after having children or for other reasons. Traditionally, in the past, I believe women have used or have benefited from part-time college courses to update their skills, which they've been able to take back into the workplace. We've seen quite a big cut in part-time vocational college places. Does that have a disproportionate effect on women returning to work? Should we be looking to reinstate some of those vocational-based college places to assist women and others returning to work?
I don't know if I've read anything that gives me any evidence on that. I mean, most people who are returning to work are returning to their original employer. So in a sense, there have been things put in place at UK levels, for example, like return to work days to try and keep people connected to their organisation. But I don't know of the impact on people who are returning to a different employer and would require some kinds of skills upgrading or skills retention.
Could I just ask a slightly related question? It relates to, is there any research to show gender pay gap according to social background in terms of disparity of wealth? Is there any, I appreciate statistics are limited, but is there any research to show that the gender pay gap may be different according to the wealth background or social background?
I think Fiona referenced earlier the fact that there are different class. So I think there's different things going on there. At the lower levels of the lower pay decile, so if you look at the lowest pay decile, that's where the lowest gender pay gap is. Now, we will assume that people in the lowest pay decile are also likely to be more disproportionately from a working class background. And therefore, there's a lower gender pay gap because actually what you've got there are effectively regulated wages by the national minimum wage. As you move up through the occupational hierarchy and the different pay deciles, then we do see a class effect, and I think Fiona might pick up on this, but particularly relating to professional work. So we know that there's a class effect in relation to professional and managerial work. People with the same qualifications occupying the same jobs are likely to be paid less, and we don't protect for that very well in the UK.
I've just been given the answer. Thank you very much.
Right. Well, perhaps you can share that with us later, all of us. Well, we're coming towards the end of our time here today, but I thought it might be throw this open to all of our guests. The question, what is the single biggest issue that, in your view, is preventing greater economic participation of women in the Scottish economy? I don't know who would like to come back on that point. Emily Thomson, first of all.
Well, that is a hard question, the single biggest issue, and I can only answer from my own perspective, which as a feminist economist, I think it's about how we value market and non-market work. When we talk about economic participation, so we want more women to participate in the economy, I would like to see us recognising that women are participating in the economy, but that their contribution is not always paid. And for me, it's about trying to change those structures and our value systems that can make more recognition of the productive work that women already engage in the home.
Thank you. And Professor Wall.
I mean, it's a
a difficult question, and I think there's not the answer you're looking for, possibly. And as the discussion around the table has indicated, what is required is a systemic response that of all the issues we've picked up, because it's not only that there are lots of issues, those issues themselves reinforce things. So the discussion that was had around wages of nursery workers and gender representation, it's you get into a series of negative circling down or positive circling up, and you need to tackle everything systemically. The great strength of a committee's piece of work like this, it can come up with a series of interlinked systemic recommendations, which as they're implemented actually start us doing things in a much better way.
Thank you. And any of our other guests like to come in? Professor Loretto?
I would very much like to endorse what Emily Thomson said. I think that's absolutely the main issue across. But if I can just maybe stick to the later life working at the moment, it's the lack of flexible working opportunities at later working life that recognise the changing balance between paid and unpaid work.
Okay. Dr. Merkurieva.
Yes. To me, it's not an immediate solution, but the first thing that comes to my mind when we talk about gender gap is the stereotypes that we are feeding to our children. So I think that's it's a long-term solution, but that's where we have to start. Because once you expose children to stereotypes, you planted the seed, and from that point on, it only grows. So.
Any further comments from our panel members on that point? Okay, and no further questions from committee members. Right, well, thank you very much. I'd like to thank all of our guests today for coming in, and we'll now suspend this session and move to private session, allowing time for the gallery, public gallery, to clear. Thank you very much.